What I wanted to say here is, I wanted to say is that I have been through this experience of the Arab Spring. It was a dream which became true in the streets in Bahrain, Manama. I do recall those memories. It's been 10 years past, and I still remember these moments, as they are so much fresh in my mind, because they also like changed my mind, changed my life forever. So it was a moment where the Bahrainis, a state which is a country, a very small island within the Gulf region, we known to be the neighbor of Saudi Arabia. The only connection of this island is there is a bridge between Saudi Arabia and Bahrain, and that's the only way people could get out of the country if they choosing a car. So it's, we known, like the people within the Gulf, they known that they live under brutal dictatorship. And this dictator came into a challenge for the first time in Bahrain. Bahrain, when it comes into the scale of the movement, it was unprecedented in the entire Arab world. But because we're a small nation, so talking about figures, within the New York Times, they spoke about 100,000. 100,000 in a population which do not exceed 600,000, it's a massive number. And if all of them, the entire population is in the street demanding democracy, demanding change, it was such a powerful message. It couldn't be any stronger. Like to have, and I think in some cases, if you have your one third of your entire population is on the street, is a massive figure that you probably would not see. And if we were in the size of Egypt, imagine how many millions that would be on the street. The reason is for this fight is not about people fighting for a bread or people fighting for, they fighting for dignity. They fighting because they had enough of dictatorship, of superpower dictating our fate, militarization. All of these issues were really the heart of the subject. So if you ask me about what was the march of a dream, it was this march of a dream was when people from a graveyard, they walk to the iconic place, which is the roundabout. The government thought that by using violence against people and opening fire against their own people, that they will terrify the public. Everyone will get scared. What happens in Bahrain is give a counter effect, and that counter effect, it just fired back. And it just caused a real reason for people to be together and to march together. And that was a march of unity, march where you can say whatever is in your mind. In a dictatorship, in a brutal policing state, this is the first time where we say down with the dictator, down with Al-Khalifa, down with the king, down with the prime minister. It was a dream becoming true, because this is where you feel freedom of speech is in action, and no one can stop us, because it's all the people came together, all of them, to have one unified message. Enough is enough. No more dictatorship. It's time for people to have their say. It's time for people to take control of their own future. And that's where we landed, to the far roundabout. And it was a beautiful moment. When people take these actions, then the government responded, and the response was violent. They crashed the demonstrators. And I remember those moments when I saw protesters after the protest will collect the tear gas canisters. They will make like, they use like a supermarket trolley to collect them all, and they just pull them together. And I went just to close to them. What struck me still is I saw on the tear gas canisters, it's written made in USA. And it was, others of them were made in the UK. This is triggered in my mind to this day, is just because when the repression starts, it's not only those abusive dictators who did this to us. It was also those who enabled them, who provided them with the arms, with the means, in order to be able to repress us. And I wanted to say, like, it's been 10 years. But throughout this, I learned so many lessons, and those lessons could have direct impact. And I am a believer in direct action. And I think a lot of what really inspired me to do this is by having a friend and colleague from CAT. I've seen it in action, and I love it. It's something sometimes it would be the only means. And I remember once, and this was, to provide details, it was on the 26th of October, 2016. a journalist told me that the King of Bahrain is meeting with Theresa May. At that time, Theresa May was the prime minister. And I thought this is a golden opportunity to send and deliver a message to the dictator in the country. And I, along with other activists, as his motor vehicle, about to enter 10 Downing Street, I literally throw myself, my body on his car, and my friend just like banged on his window. I don't know if he was on the side, on that side or not. And then as he went to Theresa May to shake hand outside 10 Downing Street, we were screaming, "Down! Why are you hosting dictators? Why are you hosting torturers?" As the police is dragging me to the police van, I felt like it was an embarrassment moment for a dictator that he thought he will be coming to get a photo op with the British Prime Minister. That was disrupted, completely ruined up. And it gave me, I said, well, if I spend my day in a prison cell today in the UK, I would be doing it with a big smile on my face, because I just literally ruined up like the PR opportunity for the king, for the dictator in the country, who is behind all this problem in the country. That moment, unfortunately, the police just stopped me. It was a direct action. They let me go, and I went home thinking everything is normal. This is then on the same night, my wife and my infant son were about to return back to London. They were on a short holiday in the country. And this is where the abuse, the security, they took it on them. They took it on the child. They took it on my wife to abuse them, to send them a message that they will not tolerate such action. So I'm saying is actions, solidarity actions, does matter. And it does upset dictators so much. They hate it. They don't like it. They don't like people from countries where they would like to meet with government. And then the people, or either individuals in exile or solidarity individuals which has sympathizes with the causes, when they send this strong message, it's extremely powerful, and the dictators will feel it. And I think if it wasn't this, then they wouldn't take direct action against my own family reprises on this basis. I wanted to end this by giving you a very solid, very strong solidarity message. I learned from it very recently, just about a few weeks ago, and it was during the 10th anniversary of the uprising. The regime this time thought the revolution is not over, so they came after children. Children as young as 11 years old were arrested because of role of anti-protest against the government. These children were 2 years old when the uprising started in 2011. I spoke to two children, which were 13. One child told me during the interrogation without his lawyer, he was asked about whether he took part in the protest. He said, they pressed me so much, so I thought I should tell them this, I did this. And he told them that. So he has his friend is 13 years old. On the other side, the prosecutor attempted to tell him, oh, you have to confess. He said, no, I didn't do it. They showed him photos, no way, So he resisted, he didn't want to tell them. And then before the judge, then they took them to a judge to decide whether they would be detained or not. So his friend told him, look, I confess to the charges. So if I say yes, you have to say yes too. So when the judge asked them, the first child said, yes, I did it. And then when he asked the second child, who refused to tell the prosecutors I did it, he said, yes, I did it. I said, why did you do this? You didn't confess. They have no evidence against you. Why did you tell this to the judge? He said, it's because of my friend. I don't want him to go to the cell alone, so I want to support him. He's my friend. I don't want to leave him. I don't want to go home without him. That's a lesson I got it from a 13-year-old boy. It just was so powerful. And this shows, it tells you so much about solidarity. And I think this is, I wanted to end my remarks at this point. Thank you so much for having me. And I mean, I'm so much grateful. I'm also very hopeful to see the new generation is pretty much seems to be quite awesome. So yeah. Thank you.